personal Helicon. As a child, they couldn't keep me from wells and old pumps with buckets and windlasses. I loved the dark drop, the trapped sky, the smells of waterweed, fungus and dank moss. One in a brickyard with a rotted board top, I savoured the rich crash when a bucket plummeted down at the end of a rope, so deep you saw no reflection in it. A shallow one under a dry stone ditch fructified like any aquarium. When you dragged out long roots from the soft mulch, a white face hovered over the bottom. Others had echoes, gave back your own call with a clean new music in it, and one was scaresome, for there, out of ferns and tall foxgloves, a rat slapped across my reflection. Now to pry into roots, to finger slime, to stare big-eyed Narcissus into some spring is beneath all adult dignity. I rhyme to see myself, to set the darkness echoing. This is from the final poem in the second book, Death of a Naturalist, Bogland. Bogland. We have no prairies to slice a big sun at evening. Everywhere the eye concedes to encroaching horizon is wooed into the cyclops' eye of a tarn. Our unfenced country is bog that keeps crusting between the sights of the sun. They've taken the skeleton of the great Irish elk out of the peat, set it up an astounding crate full of air. Butter sunk under more than 100 years was recovered, salty and white. The ground itself is kind black butter, melting and opening underfoot, missing its last definition by millions of years. They'll never dig coal here, only the waterlogged trunks of great firs, soft as pulp. Our pioneers keep striking inwards and downwards. Every layer they strip seems camped on before. The bog holes might be Atlantic seepage. The wet centre is bottomless. The Tollund Man. Someday I will go to Aarhus to see his peat-brown head, the mild pods of his eyelids, his pointed skin cap. In the flat country nearby where they dug him out, his last gruel of winter seeds caked in his stomach, naked except for the cap, noose and girdle, I will stand a long time. Bridegroom to the goddess, she tightened her torque on him and opened her fen, those dark juices working him to a saint's kept body, trove of the turf cutter's honeycombed workings. Now his stained face reposes at Aarhus. I could risk blasphemy, consecrate the cauldron bog, our holy ground, and pray him to make germinate the scattered, ambushed flesh of labourers, stockinged corpses laid out in the farmyards, telltale skin and teeth flecking the sleepers of four young brothers, trailed for miles along the lines. Something of his sad freedom as he rode the tumbril should come to me, driving, saying the names Tollund, Graubal, Nebelgord, watching the pointing hands of country people, not knowing their tongue. Out there in Jutland, in the old man-killing parishes, I will feel lost, unhappy, and at home. Casualty. He would drink by himself and raise a weathered thumb towards the high shelf, calling another rum and black currant without having to raise his voice, or order a quick stout by a lifting of the eyes and a discreet dumb show of pulling off the top. At closing time would go in waders and peaked cap into the showery dark, a dole-kept breadwinner, but a natural for work. I loved his whole manner, sure-footed but too sly, his deadpan sidling tact, his fisherman's quick eye, and turned observant back. Incomprehensible to him, my other life. Sometimes on his high stool, too busy with his knife at a tobacco plug and not meeting my eye, in the pause after a slug, he mentioned poetry. We would be on our own, and always politic and shy of condescension, I would manage by some trick to switch the talk to eels, or lore of the horse and cart, or the provisionals. But my tentative art, his turned back watches too. He was blown to bits, out drinking in a curfew others obeyed, 3 nights after they shot dead the 13 men in Derry. Paras 13, the wall said, Bogside 0. That Wednesday, everybody held his breath and trembled. It was a day of cold, raw silence, windblown surplice and soutane. Rained on, flower-laden, coffin after coffin seemed to float from the door of the packed cathedral like blossoms on slow water. The common funeral unrolled its swaddling band, lapping, tightening, till we were braced and bound like brothers in a ring. But he would not be held at home by his own crowd, whatever threats were phoned, whatever black flags waved. I see him as he turned in that bombed, offending place, remorse fused with terror on his still knowable face, his cornered, outfaced stare blinding in the flash. He had gone miles away, for he drank like a fish nightly, naturally swimming towards the lure of warm, lit-up places, the blurred mesh and murmur drifting among glasses in the gregarious smoke. How culpable was he that last night when he broke our tribe's complicity? Now, you're supposed to be an educated man, I hear him say. Puzzle me the right answer to that one. I missed his funeral. Those quiet walkers and sideways talkers shoaling out of his lane to the respectable purring of the hearse. They move in equal pace with the habitual slow consolation of a dawdling engine. The line lifted, hand over fist, cold sunshine on the water, the land banked under fog. That morning, when he took me in his boat, the screw purling, turning indolent fathoms white, I tasted freedom with him. To get out early, haul steadily off the bottom, dispraise the catch, and smile as you find a rhythm working you slow mile by mile into your proper haunt somewhere well out beyond. Dawn-sniffing revenant, plodder through midnight rain, question me again. A rowan like a lipstick girl. Between the byroad and the main road, alder trees at a wet and dripping distance stand off among the rushes. There are the mud flowers of dialect and the immortelles of perfect pitch, and that moment when the bird sings very close to the music of what happens. As you plaited the harvest bow, you implicated the mellowed silence in you, in wheat that does not rust, but brightens as it tightens twist by twist into a knowable corona, a throwaway love knot of straw. Hands that aged round ash plants and cane sticks and lapped the spurs in a lifetime of game cocks, harked to their gift and worked with fine intent until your fingers moved somnambulant. I tell and finger it like braille, gleaning the unsaid off the palpable. And if I spy into its golden loops, I see us walk between the railway slopes into an evening of long grass and midges, blue smoke straight up, old beds and ploughs in hedges, an auction notice on an outhouse wall. You with a harvest bow in your lapel, me with a fishing rod, already homesick for the big lift of these evenings, as your stick, whacking the tips off weeds and bushes, beats out of time and beats, but flushes nothing. That original townland, still tongue-tied in the straw tied by your hand. The end of art is peace, could be the motto of this frail device that I have pinned up on our deal dresser, like a drawn snare, slipped lately by the spirit of the corn, yet burnished by its passage, and still warm. When all the others were away at mass, I was all hers as we peeled potatoes. They broke the silence, let fall one by one, like solder weeping off the soldering iron. Cool comfort set between us, things to share, gleaming in a bucket of clean water. And again let fall. Little pleasant splashes from each other's work would bring us to our senses. So while the parish priest at her bedside went hammer and tongs at the prayers for the dying, and some were responding, and some crying, I remembered her head bent towards my head, her breath in mine, our fluent dipping knives. Never closer, the whole rest of our lives. The cool that came off sheets just off the line made me think the damp must still be in them. But when I took my corners of the linen and pulled against her, first straight down the hem and then diagonally, then flapped and shook the fabric like a sail in a crosswind, they made a dried-out, undulating thwack. So we'd stretch and fold and end up hand to hand for a split second, as if nothing had happened. For nothing had, that had not always happened, beforehand, day by day, just touch and go, coming close again by holding back in moves where I was X and she was O, inscribed in sheets, sheets sewn from ripped-out flour sacks. Paul, just a message to you about that poem. The X and O's are about the, I mean, there's an allusion to the game of Foxy Goosey, it was called in Ireland. It's the X's and O's, getting them in straight lines along the diagonals or along the side. So that might be a possible visual with that one. Shifting brilliancies. Then winter light in a doorway, and on the stone doorstep, a beggar shivering in silhouette. So the particular judgment might be set. Bare wallstead and a cold hearth rained into. Bright puddle where the soul-free cloud life roams. And after the commanded journey, what? Nothing magnificent, nothing unknown. A gazing out from far away, alone. And it is not particular at all, just old truth dawning. There is no next time round. Unroofed scope, knowledge freshening wind. Once, as a child, out in a field of sheep, Thomas Hardy pretended to be dead and lay down flat among their dainty shins. In that sniffed at, bleated into, grassy space, he experimented with infinity. His small, cool brow was like an anvil waiting for the sky to make it sing the perfect pitch of his dumb being. And that stir he caused in the fleece hustle was the original of a ripple that would travel 80 years outward from there, to be the same ripple inside him at its last circumference. I misremembered. He went down on all fours, Florence Emily says, crossing a yew lease. Hardy sought the creatures face to face. Their witless eyes and liability to panic made him feel less alone, made proleptic sorrow stand a moment over him, perfectly known and sure. And then the flock's dismay went swimming on into the blinks and murmurs and deflections he'd know at parties in renowned old age, when sometimes he imagined himself a ghost and circulated with that new perspective. The annals say, when the monks of Clonmacnoise were all at prayers inside the oratory, a ship appeared above them in the air. The anchor dragged along behind so deep it hooked itself into the altar rails, and then, as the big hull rocked to a standstill, a crewman shinned and grappled down the rope and struggled to release it, but in vain. This man can't bear our life here and will drown, the abbot said, unless we help him. So they did. The freed ship sailed, and the man climbed back out of the marvelous as he had known it.